I now hand the conference over to Mr. Mayank Bhandari from Nirmal Bang Equities. Thank you, and over to you, sir.
Thank you, Faizan. Nirmal Bang Equities welcome to you all for 4Q FY21 result conference call of IFB Industries. Management is represented by Mr. Probir Chatterjee, Director and CFO, Mr. Rajashankar Ray, MD and CEO of Home Appliance Division, Mr. Arup Das, Head of Marketing and Engineering Division, Mr. Anand Reddy, CEO of Motors Division. I now hand over the call to management for opening remarks, post which we can take questions from participants. Thank you and over to you, sir.
Thank you, Mayank. Good evening to all of you. I welcome you all for IFB Industries Investors Call for the fourth quarter FY21. Hope all of you and your family members are healthy and safe during this uncertain, unprecedented and challenging time. Today we have with us Mr. Rajashankar Ray, MD and CEO of Home Appliance Division, Mr. Arup Das, Head of Engineering, Head of Marketing Engineering Division, and Mr. Anand Reddy, CEO of Motor Division. With this, I will start the commentary. During the fourth quarter ended March 21, the company has reported a total income of 805.56 crores, a growth of 64.4% over the corresponding quarter of the previous year. EBITDA for the quarter was 58.4 crore with a margin of 7.2%, as against 1.2% over the corresponding quarter of the previous year. The revenue during the quarter was below expectation. As a result, margin was also not well as per our expectation. Also, I need to mention that current tax during the quarter was high, because we received a government grant of 17.02 crore under MCFs, which is taxable as per Income Tax Act. However, as per Ind AS 20, revenue recognition will be spread over the useful life of asset. Impact of this was rupees 6 crore, and along with this, there is an impact of 4 crores on account of brought forward losses, without which the rate of taxes 24%. For the year ending period March 2021, company reported total income of 2735.66 crore with a growth of 6.7% over the corresponding period of the previous year. Growth in YTD period was lower due to loss of operation in April and May due to COVID. EBITDA amount for the period was rupees 228 crores with a margin of 8.3% as compared to 5.1% during the same period of the previous year. There has been significant improvement in the margin, and it has gone up by 320 basis points due to lower material cost and operating expenses. YTD tax has also been similarly affected as mentioned above. With this, I will request you to start the question and answer session.
Thank you very much. We will now begin the question and answer session. Anyone who wishes to ask a question may press star and one on their touchtone telephone. If you wish to remove yourself from the question queue, you can press star and two. Participants are requested to use handsets while asking a question. Ladies and gentlemen, we will wait for a moment while the question queue assembles. Reminder to the participants, anyone who wishes to ask a question may press star and one at this time. The first question is from the line of Abhishek Ghosh from DSP Mutual Fund. Please go ahead.
Yeah, hi sir. Thank you so much for the opportunity. Sir, if you can just help us understand this, receipt of 17 crore, was it pertaining to the quarter?
No, this is, you know, this is a capital grant given by the government under MCF, that when we spend money on the capex on AC, on that there was a 25% subsidy given actually, which we received during the period of February and March first week.
So, That's what I'm saying. For the quarter, the revenues are higher to the extent of 17 crore.
No, it is not considered in the revenue. That is what I said. As per Ind AS 20, this is spread over the useful life of the asset. In that case, it will be spread over 13 years.
Okay. So it's not part of
12, we got only 12 lakhs during the period.
Okay. Okay. And sir, there is a sharp increase in the revenues of dishwasher. Hello?
Carry on.
Yeah, so we've done almost a very high number in fourth quarter. If you can just help us with the outlook of that segment.
Mr. Ray, I would request you to take it forward, please.
Yes, Rajshankar here. The demand on the dishwasher actually has been increasing consistently since June 20, when the first wave of lockdowns started, getting released, and we expect that whatever sales run rate we registered in the fourth quarter will actually increase even further now that the supply situation is much more stable than it was in the last year. This increase in volume is coming because the market has been reset.
Okay. So you've done almost about 87 crores for the quarter, if I'm not wrong. And what you are hinting at, that the revenue run rate can even further move up here. Is that the way to look at it?
Yeah, we have done around 95 crores actually, 94.73 crores for the quarter.
Okay. Okay. And this is mostly you manufacture it in-house, or how does it work?
So the dishwasher is bought out currently as a CBU. And for the foreseeable future, it will remain as a bought out CBU.
Okay. And sir, you have also spoken about effective Jan 21, you have taken a price increase, and also you have spoken about the industry participants. If you can help us understand, what is the price increase that you have taken, and did the industry also take price hike in 4Q, or was it more a phenomenon of 1Q FY 22?
The blended price increase that we took was between 7-9%, and we had made the price increase in January 21. The industry actually largely did not change prices. They held it till March. They began to do some increases from April, but then the lockdown was in place. We have to wait and watch what they do now that the markets are opening up. My own personal expectation is that everybody will pass through the increase, because the impact on the raw material has been extremely high from November last year to, and it is still continuing. So we expect even Q2 to be to see price increases on the material cost side.
And the 7-9% of blended price increase that you took, you have largely covered for the raw material price increase, or
So we were covered for the raw material price increases up to January. There have been further price increases in April, and we have to evaluate how much can be passed through once the markets are stable.
Okay, so you have not implemented any price hike in 1Q FY22.
Yes, that's right. The price increase we took was in January. As of now, April, half of April was almost under lockdown. May and June, we would expect maybe by the first week of July, the markets to be stable. We will then look at the pricing situation maybe in early August.
Okay. And sir, have you lost market share in 4Q FY21 because you took price hike, while the industry did not take any color there?
Yes, that point is correct. We lost market share because two of the major competitions decided to undercut us. after we increased price in January and they held it in Feb and March. So for the period of Feb and March, yes, we did lose market share.
Okay. And have those competition initiated the subsequent price hikes in 1Q FY22 because it's almost 1Q is almost over, or have they still lagged?
We were watching in April and they had begun to pass through on the price increases.
Mm-hmm.
But April, you know, after 20th was practically sort of shutting down of the markets.
Correct.
And May and June has been fully closed. So my own expectation is that when the markets open, they will pass it through. But we have to wait and watch because they didn't change prices in February, March.
Okay. And so just one more thing, you will be launching the front load 8 kg segment as well, which will come in by 2Q FY22. If you can help us understand what proportion of the front load market is that 8 kg segment?
We are already in 8 kg.
I think you'll be launching in the top load in that case.
In the top loads, we are also present in 8 kg. And in fact, in this quarter, we will be launching capacities up to 11 kg. Could you tell me which point you're referring to? I'll be able to answer it.
I will just come back to this one because the presentation is pretty elaborate. I just went through.
Okay.
And I'll just come back to you on this one. Sir, the other thing is in the AC segment, if you can just help us with your, you have sold about 50,000 is what you mentioned vis-a-vis a budgeted of 1 lakh. If you can help us with what is the current capacity, and what is the contracted out capacity and what is your own kind of volume that you're looking at, and how should one look at the revenues or the volumes as far as the AC segment is concerned?
So our capacity, which we have also shared earlier, is 500,000 per annum for the investment on air conditioners which we have put in. And The targeted breakup that we had shared is that there is no annual contracted capacity commitment in that sense, but there are OEM contracts in place, and we expect that the volume on an annual basis will be roughly about 200,000. And our own internal target was that we should be selling at least 200,000 of the ISB brand, so therefore 400,000. Now, what has happened for us in the AC segment is that the plant actually, as soon as it started last year, we had the first wave of the lockdown, and that washed out last year's season. And this year, our build-up was starting, but again, we've had a lockdown. So, the industry billing of the Q4 is largely sitting in the channel because no sales happened and the billing from the industry in Jan-Feb, March, etc. was quite high. So, once the markets open and the situation is stable in July, we expect pent-up demand. And our focus will be to get back whatever we have lost and maximize our sales from July onwards, running up to March of this fiscal year. We don't think that the OEM volumes are going to be a problem. We also think that with the channel-related work that we have done over the last few months, and specifically the response to the new ACs that we got, that our own volumes will also be healthy from July, August onwards. So some initial 2-3 months of pent-up demand, which has not been serviced, and we don't have any inventories in the channel. So that benefit we should get, and followed by, of course, the season. Does that answer your question, please?
Yeah. So just one last question. When we look at your margin profile, we had seen very strong improvement in 2Q, 3Q of double-digit margins. But again, that has gone back to sub 7% margins of about 6.5% for the fourth quarter. So the volatility in the margin continues, right? Because that was also the how should one look at the margins going forward internally? How are you looking at it given the pressure in raw material negative operating leverage, all those factors, how should one look at the margin profile more from a medium term perspective?
Yes, so that's an absolutely the right thing to ask. And if you look at our Q2 and Q3 performance versus Q4, the three margin drivers that we have, one is we have very healthy gross margins on the washer segment, and when the volumes of that are in line with what we should be delivering, the basic gross margin stays high. And on top of that, the air conditioner comes in, and the material cost profile of the air conditioner was going to be very healthy with the localization of the controller, which is presently under imports. And compared to Q3, what happened in Q4 is that the basic volume of the washers went down because of this pricing issue, and the margin structure on the air conditioners could not be fixed because of the you know, it was a near panic or extreme stress on the electronic side. So the component imports were affected. Our own localization program was affected. So what was to be completed in early Jan is now going to be completed in the Q2. So as far as our margin construct is concerned, if the volume of the washers remains in line with what it should be, the AC material cost profile is fixed, then the margin remains healthy. And it is, of course, helped by products like dishwashers, microwaves, etc., for which the general demand in the market is much higher than before.
Oh.
So going forward, the three margin drivers are the washer volumes, the AC material cost profile, and, of course, the added benefits from products like microwaves and dishwasher gross margin accumulation.
Okay, sir. Thank you so much for answering my questions. Mm-hmm. I'll come back in the... Thanks. Yeah.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Nirav Vasa from Anand Rathi. Please go ahead.
Hello, sir, and thank you very much for the opportunity. My first question pertains to PLI for air conditioners. So, sir, as we see from the document, there is a lot of focus on creating the ecosystem for air conditioners. So, how does that, how are we preparing ourselves to address this opportunity?
The final shape of the PLI, which the government formalized, lays stress on investments downstream, which is basically on the component side.
Mm-hmm.
So, for IFB, the PLI benefits can come from the planned IFB investments in motors, for which there is a project that we are starting and which will be completed in this fiscal year. There is no PLI per se on the sales of finished goods products. And on the component side, so let us say some of our suppliers make investments in electronics or in other areas around the air conditioner, they will be able to access PLI, and part of that benefit will flow to us. So the PLI construct that the government has taken is slightly more long-term. It will not have immediate impact in terms of margins because of some percentage that you're getting on sales. But it is the right direction as per us, because over a 2-3 year kind of a period, it will definitely build supplier capacity in India.
And sir, getting new customers is also very important, you know, that you are talking for the capacity for air conditioners. Any success in that?
We have had
scenario was not very great, but just...
We have had actually a lot of inquiry around the OEM sourcing. But what we had wanted is to work with a few players for the kind of the product quality that we have in our air conditioners, which would be higher priced than the typical OEM supplier. And to that extent, our internal estimate of 200,000, we have more or less filled that capacity on a per annum basis. Now, we will service this, and then as the further expansion comes, then we will plan it. Does that answer your question, please?
Yeah, sorry, it does. But if I look at the other categories in which you are present, would you be open to replicating this model also? Because I believe there is a lot of demand for outsourcing of bigger equipments like washing machines in which you are already present?
So that is a very good question. It is something that we discuss internally as well. But as on date, there is no conclusion on servicing OEM with the products other than the air conditioners. We have been approached by people. Those opportunities we are evaluating, but there is no decision taken by them.
And sir, my final question would be on the BEE rating. Sir, as you are aware that the Bureau of Energy Efficiency is looking to revise energy ratings, and after a delay of multiple times, it is now expected to be implemented by the end of this calendar year. But there are mixed views from the industry. So, sir, just wanted to get your thoughts on the same.
So, we would be very happy if it changes on time, because when we designed our present air conditioner platform, it is already capable of the energy norms that were supposed to have come last year. The reason why the industry is essentially resisting this is because they don't want to make the investments for producing the air conditioners that the new energy norms warrant. But we are ready, and if it is 1st April, we'd be more than happy to change over to the new norm on 1st of April.
Sir, but sorry to cut.
Yes, yes, please.
So, sir,
yes.
Just wanted to understand, if this BEE rating happens, as per my understanding, like, it is mainly with every rating changes, there the focus increases more and more towards electrical component of the air conditioners. That is towards the PCB boards, circuits, and those kind of things, which consume less power and give higher efficiency, and maybe something in the coolant aspect. So how do we have a significant edge as compared to peers? Can you, if you can elaborate a bit more, that would be really grateful.
Okay. So the energy efficiency that the air conditioner delivers comes from 2-3 elements. So the first is the compressor specification. So there is a practice in the industry to essentially use a lower spec compressor to try and deliver a higher power. And if you look at the ISB air conditioners, we use twin rotary compressors, which is quite unique in the industry. Most of the mainline players don't use it. And a measure of that is the kind of power that we deliver. We are the highest in the industry in terms of power delivered. Mm-hmm. So the first is the compressor. The second is the essential design of the heat exchangers. So if you look at the total surface area of the fin, and typically the industry language is rows. So some people try to manage with one row, some people manage with 1.5 row. We are giving 2-row condensers. Mm-hmm. And therefore the essential surface area for heat exchange is much more. And as you move to higher energy efficiency, you need to have better heat exchange capability, which means you need more surface. And the third is the essential capability of the controller to manage the fine-tuning of the running of the compressor. So the controller is a little bit more expensive, essentially because it has to have more power to control the compressor more accurately. So as far as our platform is concerned, the compressor platform, the heat exchanger platform, and the controller platform, all three are already in place. Because when we began manufacturing, we were ready for the new energy norm. Mm-hmm. So for us, it is a minor tweak to deliver what is required as per the new norm.
So just one more thing. Sir, there were some industry players are also saying that because now copper prices has risen exponentially, industry players are also thinking of shifting from copper to aluminium. Any thoughts on that? Do you think it is possible?
It is technically absolutely viable to move from copper to aluminium. If you look at the automotive industry and you look at radiators and engine parts, everyone has moved from copper to aluminium years back. But somehow in the air conditioner industry, the customers has never been positive towards aluminium. And some of the reasons behind that were large-scale failures on aluminium condensers that specifically one manufacturer had problems with, and it sort of created this perception. So I don't think it is a technical issue. but whether the Indian consumer will accept a condenser in aluminium instead of copper, we have to wait and see. As of now, the customer is willing to pay the extra price because the customer believes that copper is a better heat conductor than aluminium. It is more a market perception issue, actually, than a technical issue.
Perfect, sir. Thank you very much for your time and patiently answering my queries. All the best. Thank you.
Thank you. Reminder to the participants, anyone who wishes to ask a question may press star and one. The next question is from the line of Rajesh Kothari from Alpha Accurate Advisors. Please go ahead.
Good evening, sir. My first question is, can you elaborate a little bit in terms of the competition intensity in the washing machine segment, particularly from hair kind of a player, and also for other segments? How do you see that over next 12, 18, 24 months?
For our kind of price and product position, we don't see any increased intensity from higher. Essentially because it operates at lower price points, and that will always remain. So today it is higher, tomorrow it is someone else. If you say overall, has the competitive intensity increased in the washer segment? My answer would be that it remains the same. It is being competitive, it will remain competitive. And players occasionally, like two of the mainline players did in February and March, occasionally they will basically use price tactics to undercut. But it can only be a short-term phenomenon. You cannot undercut in perpetuity.
Okay. And what would be, do you disclose your market share, say, over last 3 years, FY19, FY20, FY21, for each of your segments?
Yes, we give indications based on our own estimates, because the publicly shared data is erroneous. We do give indications.
So what would be your market share gain or loss in FY21 for all your segments?
Gain or loss in FY21?
Yeah.
So FY21 compared to FY20 was the same in terms of market share. But our assessment is that in the Feb, March, and let's say first 2 weeks of April, we have lost about 2.5 to 3% share because of the pricing issue that I spoke about. We believe that share will come back, because once the competition starts increasing price from now, when the market's open. As far as categories like dishwashers, microwaves, etc. are concerned, our shares have been stable if you look at the last 2-3 years.
Okay. And typically, what is your total, branding spend as a percentage of revenue?
Mr. Chatterjee, would you like to answer that?
Yeah, last year we spent around 2.03%.
Okay. And going forward also, you plan to spend about 2%, 2.5-3%, or how it works?
Yes, around that.
Okay. Fine. And last question from my side, in terms of the contract manufacturing, what you are talking from the AC plant, 2 lakh capacity, which you are almost booked from, your customers. Now, this will start by when?
Sorry, could you just repeat that question?
The AC plant, what you're talking about, the 2 lakh, capacity, you said that, you almost tied up, from...
So, this started in March, in April also, but unfortunately, after that, there was a lockdown. So, looking at their inventory, etc., I would expect that the cycle will again start from mid-July, because I would expect that the markets would be fully open by first week of July.
Okay, so you are basically saying that as and when the things normalize from day one, from June, July, whenever, you are almost 100% utilization. That's what you are trying to suggest?
Yes, No, it will not be 100% utilization. It will be lesser because if you look at 100% utilization, then it comes to roughly about 40,000 a month. We are not going to get 40,000 a month in July, August, September. But the pent-up demand of May and June, and looking at their inventory positions, we have to see what kind of a figure comes in the first 2-3 months after the markets open.
Okay.
From, let us say, November, December onwards, when you know, the inventory build-up starts, we will be running full capacity.
Okay. From November, December, you will be running full capacity?
Yes, yes.
Okay. Okay, sir. You know, one strategic related question. You know, if I look at, you know, IFP in last, you know, 5-7 years, you know, our margins were basically at the lower end, and of course, FY21 we have seen significant improvement in margins. So basically, what are the steps which you have taken, which you think it will you know, make these margins more sustainable in nature? Because the big brands, whether it's Voltas or whether it's Whirlpool, whether it is Havells, you know, they were big budgets, you know, they were big presence, you know, they were wide distribution network. So, you know, and if I look at Voltas, for example, the best of the margins were about 10-12% kind of EBITDA margins. So what makes it that, you know, either we need to spend like our competitors to get to a wider reach, to get a wider presence at the same price point, or all we need to do something else to maintain this margin, right? So can you give some color on that?
Yeah, so our margin profile and being able to deliver levels like Q2, Q3 of the previous fiscal year come from actually 2-3 points. The first is we don't really need to increase spend per se to increase revenues, because the channel network that we have and the extraction from that network has been continuously increasing because of actions we've taken on the ground. And the channel extraction was in full flow in Q2 and Q3. We just need sustainable volumes similar to what we were enjoying in Q2, Q3, which we had in January, but then we didn't have it in February, March. So the first thing is the volumes of the washers. The second is that the air conditioner adds gross margin onto the company, because there has been no increase per se on the sales side of the manning or the service side of the manning. It's just the additional people in the plant level. So the air conditioner is very good in terms of gross margin accretion. And we need to complete the controller localization project, because that adds a significant margin to this product category. So the first action, washer volume. The second action, the controller's localization on air conditioner. And the third action, which I just mentioned a while earlier, is that there are some categories in which we have very healthy volumes now. Microwaves, where our position is among the top two in India. Dishwashers, where the pandemic has helped the market to expand, so the volumes have significantly increased and can increase further. And then we have product categories like industrial products, kitchen appliance products, all of which have very high gross margin profile. So the third point is to maximize the volumes from these categories. So washer volumes as the first pillar, air conditioner, material cost profile led by the controller, the second pillar, and the third pillar is the volumes in the segments like microwaves, dishwashers, etc. So these are the three. And in none of these three do we really need to increase spend to drive revenues. If we do these three well, I think this expectation that we deliver consistent margins and not have volatility, that will get answered. Okay. Does that answer your question, please?
Yeah, you are right, you know, partially. But I was just looking at, you know, from a different perspective, that if I look at the history of IFT industries from FY12 to FY20, we had 4-6% EBITDA margin story. In FY21, particularly in 2Q and 3Q, we have seen significant increase in margins because of the, of course, the demand growth has been very, very encouraging. And I'm just trying to wonder that, you know, because people were already bought it, correct? And these are very, very long cycle products. These are not, you know, 1 year, 2 year replacement cycle. These are like 5, 7, 10, 12, 15 years replacement cycle products. So whether, you know, same kind of a demand growth will come back, because you know, the historically, if you look at India, then growth, whether it's AC, whether it's washing machine, whether it's a refrigerator, it has been, you know, 7, 9, 10, 12% CAGR over last 5, 7, 8, 9 years. So, you know, unless and until this growth sustains to, you know, and moves to 18-20%, then yes, you are right. But if, let's assume, if it comes back to, you know, 7-8%, which was the historical growth trends, then what happens to our margins?
So that's a very good question. And if you look at, and a lot of the data of the last year is quite relevant, because if you look at growth rates, the growth rates from tier 2, tier 3 have been very high. And penetration levels in tier 2, tier 3 are very low. So if you look at overall India, and if you look at, let's say, front-loading penetration, it would be maybe 3%, 4%. Washer penetration is sitting at about 8 to 10%. If you go to tier 2, tier 3, that value of 8 to 10% will probably drop to 4% or 5%. So penetration is very low. And for ISB, what this means is that over the last, let's say, 3 to 4 years, we made a lot of addition in network, specifically in the tier 2, tier 3 areas. And we need to get the extraction right from this network. And I think that will give sustainable growth exactly of the type that you have described.
Thank you. Mr. Kothari, may we request that you return to the question queue for follow-up questions? Thank you. The next question is from the line of Abhishek Ghosh from DSP Mutual Fund. Please go ahead.
Hi, sir. Just continuing on the AC part. So while, you know, now you're going a little more aggressive on the AC part, so what has been your experience in terms of what is the price point of your AC in terms of where have you kind of benchmarked it or kept it at a discount to the market leader or peers, if you can just help us understand with that. And the ease or the difficulty with which you're able to place a product, because in AC you already have more than 40-50 brands already. So what is your experience, if you can just help us understand with that?
So if I have to answer this very specifically, and if I take the example of let's say a 1.5 ton three-star air conditioner, which is the highest volume segment, then for the product that we introduced in the market, we had a price position of 37,000 to 37,500. If you look at the segment per se, there were people selling it at 34,000, but we stayed above the mass. And in fact, since we started till now, and because it was sort of an erratic kind of market largely closed last year, we had an initial struggle in explaining to the market why this price point is right for the product which is being offered. And there was a lot of resistance, especially from the larger dealers, etc. But what happened in the Jan to March period, specifically, let's say from February to April, is that once the initial placements were made and the customers started buying them, the feedback of the air conditioners was very, very positive. So as on date, for the price position we have, which is higher end of the mid segment, we are very comfortable with our pricing. And I think the hard work in establishing the pricing has been done. Now it is about getting the channel extraction and the counter shares. Our placements are in many more counters than what it was, let's say, 7 or 8 months back.
Okay, okay. And, sir, in terms of the contract manufacturing part of the AC, you know, the earlier apprehension was that since you're also a brand, you could have, you know, there's a conflict of interest there. So how has been the response from whatever interaction that you've had with either present clients or potential clients as far as the contract manufacturing part of the AC is concerned?
It's actually been quite pleasant. We've not had that problem of us being perceived as competition. It's been quite complimentary, actually. So that didn't happen.
Okay. Okay. And what is the peak revenues adjusted for the seasonality in AC? that you can do with the current gross block, because there's a seasonality element there. So what is the realistic peak revenues that you can do given the current gross block of the AC segment?
So if you see, in any given month, we can go up to 35,000 in the month easily and 40,000 in the month with a stretch. So 40,000 is what we can do. But when we are in the peak season, what we will be doing is we'll be using inventory which is produced earlier. And therefore, the sales peak will be more than 40,000. But we will address it through inventory. The other thing is that there are very minor things to be done in the plant level to increase the 40,000 beyond 40,000.
Okay.
Does that give you what you wanted in terms of details?
Yeah. That's helpful. And in terms of the revenue mix, as you rightly pointed out, in the current quarter, your top load plus front load is sub 50%. Which is usually something like 60% in a regular quarter, and that's probably the reason for gross margin. So if you can just help us understand the contribution margin difference between, and without quantifying, just broadly, that is a dishwasher contribution margin much inferior to that of washing machine or an AC? How should one look at it from that perspective?
So the dishwasher gross contributions are similar to the washers. And the air conditioners are lower today. Once we complete the controller localization, they will not be as high as the washers, but in percentage terms, they'll still be significant. In the washers, we have very significant gross margin.
Okay. And just two last questions. One is, in the IFP point or the distribution mix, what is your current touch point and mix of that? Because you mentioned you've added a lot of them in the tier 2, tier 3 cities. A mix of that would be helpful.
See, IFB points contribute about 13-14% of our sales. And distribution, which was sort of hovering at 2-3%, over the last 2 years has now moved up to 15-16%.
No, I didn't get it, sir. What distribution was 2.3%?
The distribution segment, which is indirect dealers, let's say 3 years back, that was hovering at 2-3%, very minuscule. It has now risen to roughly about 15% of sales.
And what are the other, so 30% is IFB and distribution points. What are the other modes?
E-commerce would be roughly around 14-15%.
Okay.
The remaining is the multi-brand dealers who we service directly.
Oh. MBO is that other one? Okay.
Yes, that's right. Yeah.
Okay. And
which includes key accounts.
Sure. And one last question. Any thoughts of getting into a new product now that AC has now kind of come in, going into a refrigerator or any other adjacent categories? Any thoughts?
Those are being evaluated, but as of now, there is no decision on that. But there is an internal evaluation that is ongoing.
Okay. Okay, sir. Thank you so much for answering my questions and wish you all the best.
Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, in order to ensure that the management is able to address questions from all participants in the conference, please limit your questions to 2 per participant. Should you have a follow-up question, we would request you to rejoin the question queue. The next question is from the line of Pavan Kumar from Ratnatraya Capital. Please go ahead.
Sir, can you explain the gross block addition in the sense there has not been much of property plant equipment addition in this current year, but AC plant is you have done significant capex on ACs, I suppose.
I will tell you, last year our total addition was 115 crores. The AC, largely it was done year before, but around 44 crores were spending, which is done during this year. Washing plant, including routine, we did around 19 crores. And engineering division, we have done around 48 crores, mainly in Bangalore and some part in Calcutta.
Okay, so has all the AC plant capex got capitalized as of now?
Yes.
Okay, there is nothing lying in.
I think around 4 to 5 crores of additional capex should be capitalized this year.
Okay, and should we assume the depreciation absolute level to be steady from here on?
Yeah, it is expected because you know the if you see the compared to last year was around 89 crores. It has gone to 99 crores actually, the depreciation.
Right. And what would be the capex plans going forward, sir, for FY22 and FY23?
The current year, actually, for engineering division, we have around routine capex of around 17 crores.
Okay.
And for motor division, we have around 34 crores. For the washing machine and appliance division, because of this pandemic situation, we are yet to decide on the outlay. We'll decide once situation normalizes.
But
of course, there could be little routine capex like every year.
Okay, but yeah, are there any any numbers in our mind when we look at medium-term planning?
That's what we are working on it because once this situation normalizes, we'll decide and come back to you maybe next quarter or quarter after that.
Okay, and one last question. Can you give us the contribution of contract manufacturing in this particular quarter, exactly Q4?
Arisan?
Can we give it to you offline, please?
Okay, sir. If you can give me your email ID, I will just do that.
Mr. Chatterjee, you can just connect with him. He'll give it to you.
Because you know, you can get in the investor's presentation at the backside. My email ID is there.
Okay. Fine, I'll mail. Thank you.
Reminder to the participants, anyone who wishes to ask a question may press star and one. The next question is from the line of Pritesh Chheda from Lucky Investments. Please go ahead.
So I have one question on margins. I actually couldn't still get a fix because our annual margins have changed a lot from 4 to 6% to what we said about 8.5% in FY21. With the revenue scale rising higher, do you see these margins sustaining and going higher? Because let's say some of your peer sets who are also in a product like AC have a better margin than you. So these 9%, 8-9% margin, what you have reported in FY21, first of all, are these sustainable and with the business base rising higher, can they expand?
Mr. Chatterjee, would you like to answer that?
You answer, please.
So we wouldn't want to give a forward guidance on this, but as we said, the areas specific to the margin related area, one is we need to get this AC controller localization done, and that is accretive to AC margins. And the volume benefits from the washer segment and the other segments is also helpful to gross margin accumulation. So,
but sir, AC is just 10% of your revenues. You have more than 75% of your revenues coming from your core products, which is washer and microwave, and then you have this other emerging core product in the form of dishwasher. So at least on the 75% of your business, and obviously this 8-9% margin that we have seen is not purely because of AC, right? So
yes, that's right. Last year's improvement in margin is driven by the core product category.
Yes.
And revenue expansion in this is accretive to margin. Yes.
Okay. And my other question is, sir, the dishwasher, what could be a dishwasher revenue for FY21?
Last year it was around 97 crores.
It was 97 for full year?
No, just one minute.
Ah, you said 95 for quarter four.
Okay, you were talking about the YTD, no?
Full year, yeah.
The last year was 104 crores.
and 95 for quarter four.
Just 1 minute. Quarter four, I'll just tell you. Quarter four was 95 crores, 94.73, and the YTD was 312 crores.
Now, this category, can it grow at 30-40% considering this category would have emerged under COVID and there would be a lot more willing buyers to now buy a dishwasher? Is it a possibility, sir?
It is a possibility because this category is now driven by availability. Whatever has happened in the last 1 year, the idea that hygiene is important, everywhere the concept of a dishwasher has really traveled. And now, for a player like IFB, the challenge is that we need to display this everywhere. If we display this everywhere, the volume benefits will come from everywhere. So, the more we expand placements, the more this volume will grow.
Okay. And here the margins, because it's a bought out, right, for us?
It's a bought out, but gross margins are healthy in this category.
On the EBITDA side, will it match this the margin of a core product?
It will be slightly lesser, but it's healthy.
Okay. Because in the market, any case, there are only a couple of players until last year who were selling dishwasher, yourself and Siemens.
Okay, I want to make one correction actually. Actually, dishwasher fourth quarter was 31.5 crores and YTD was 104.77 crores. YTD.
Okay.
Sorry.
So, how much did dishwasher grow then in FY21? 105 versus?
It grew by 134% last year in value terms.
Okay. So then there has to be not 30-40% growth. There can be a much higher growth.
Yes. Right? Yes.
Yeah, because I was wondering 300 crore.
No.
Okay. Thank you very much, sir. Thank you.
The next question is from the line of Rashmi Koja from Kotak Securities. Please go ahead.
So my question was on the AC segment. What could be the margin difference between what you're going to do in for the 2 lakh capacity of contract manufacturing versus the 2 lakh capacity you're thinking of setting on your own? That is one. And the second is, can the overall revenue run rate on an annualized basis at optimum utilization go above 1,000 crore for the company?
So, that second question that you had asked, this had come up in the previous investor call also. And yes, the potential for the company is more than 1,000 crores on the air conditioner segment. We need to realize it through the OEM sales and through our own expansion of our network sales. So that is the answer to the second part of your question. As far as the first for the first part is concerned, as far as the OEM sales are concerned, the margin is up to the dispatch from the plant to the OEM. And as far as the own brand sales are concerned, after the plant, you have all the overheads related to the sales and marketing. For the company, we expect going forward that actually the net might be similar. This is what we are working towards.
Okay. And similar question, will the margin on AC actually be higher than your overall EBITDA margin of 8-9% that you have been working on in FY21?
It will take us some time to reach that level. We have to finish the controller localization, wait for basically wait for the markets to stabilize. The way we look at it, more than the EBITDA percentage on a category, what is happening with the growth of categories like air conditioners, dishwashers, etc., is that the gross margin accumulation is increasing, whereas the fixed overhead in terms of the cost of a salesperson or marketing, it remains similar with a slight increase. So at a company level, it is definitely accretive. Have I been able to explain that to you?
Yeah. Thank you, sir.
Okay.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Deepak Mehta, individual investor. Please go ahead.
Yeah, thank you for taking my question. Sir, my question is on the long term. So if we say 5 to 6 years, so if we say our country is targeting, you know, 5 trillion economy of opportunity, so your brand comes in premium segment. So what can be your market share going forward and revenue you are looking for if the, you know, per capita income get increased? So how, what kind of CAGR we can expect in the best scenario, sir?
If we answer that, it's like a forward forecast. So that would not really be right. But if you
look at estimate, sir. Rough estimate, not... Because it's a forward-looking statement, so rough.
Yeah. So if you look at the kind of growth rate that IFB has had, and you can go back 6-7 years period and have a look at it, the growth rate on the core categories is accelerating because the penetration is increasing, and the growth rate from air conditioners will be in addition to that growth rate. So if you put these two together, it makes for fairly healthy sales growth potential for IFB. We wouldn't want to give a specific number to this, but if you look at these two indices, you will see a fairly healthy growth rate, which we should deliver.
Okay, sir. And what is your margin in e-commerce platform? Is it same as retail, or if you can throw some color?
It's similar. It's similar.
Similar.
Thank you. Mr. Mehta, may we request that you return to the question queue for follow-up questions. Thank you. The next question is from the line of Shrikant, individual investor. Please go ahead.
Thank you for the opportunity for the question. I just had one question on the cost opportunity that we were working on for the last few quarters, where we were trying to, you know, increase the volume of the purchase across different lines, because I think they're having same kind of raw material also. Just wanted to understand, how is it panning out?
So the material cost took a hit from December to April, where the rise in the commodities the rise in the electronic purchase rates and freight was just totally out of control. So even though the plans on the material cost in terms of alternate sources, newer designs, all those were basically in place and all are in implementation, but the basic material cost was quite negatively impacted. And we have to wait for this to stabilize, because it is still not stable. The steel industry continues to, you know, drive inflationary pressures, because they are increasing pricing even though there doesn't seem to be a logical reason. Plastics have stabilized a little bit. Electronics is still high. So my answer to you is that yes, all the plans are in implementation, but the basic rise in the commodities has taken away a lot of the positive impact.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Pavan Kumar from Ratnatraya Capital. Please go ahead.
Sir, I wanted to understand your capital structure better, your cost structure better. In the sense, post gross margins, how much do you think, what part of the absolute cost would be fixed?
See, around 25 to 26% of the cost is fixed. Others are variable in nature. I am talking from the operating expense side.
Okay, and when you are saying 25 to 26%, that is as a proportion of your current revenues.
Yeah. No, I am saying, suppose operating expense is 100, out of that, 25% is fixed, 75% is variable.
Okay. So for that 25%, if our scale goes up, we should benefit
yeah.
from that.
And this is one, and the staff cost to a large extent, it is maybe, 8-10% varies. That again will be diluted with higher volume.
Okay, that is not included in this 25%, right?
That I separated operating expenses separately, because there are three major items: material, staff cost, and the operating expenses.
Okay, sir, thanks.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Shubham Rajgaria from Westbridge Capital. Please go ahead.
Yes. My one question was that the commodity prices have increased. So could you give a sense that what's the total cost in increase in the raw material prices? And is there any cost reduction plan which is taking place, or you're working on that? If you could give some sense there.
The blended increase in the material cost from, let us say, November, December to April would be around 12-13%. Driven by commodities, etc. This varies from model to model and across categories. And yes, we are working on ideas on how to knock this off.
Got it. And when you say these ideas, will it involve replacement of these commodities with some other commodities, or could you give us some ideas on the levers are there?
So the ideas are mainly in two buckets: alternate sourcing, and the second is value engineering ideas, which were in the pipeline, which we are speeding up because of the impact of this of the commodities.
Got it. Thank you. Those are my questions.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Rasmi Koja from Kotak Securities. Please go ahead.
Well, I had a question on the distribution side. As compared to our peers, how well are we in terms of penetration? One is that, and especially in tier 2, tier 3 cities, how are we placed as compared to peers in terms of distribution? That was the first. And second is there any scope for increasing the distribution penetration materially in the next 2-3 years, which can have a big jump in the revenue profile?
Okay. So if you look at a category like washers, our weighted distribution is between 85-90%. So it is more or less at the benchmark level. If you look at a category like air conditioners, our distribution is still very, very low compared to the industry benchmarks. Our internal target is that as on date, we have a presence across roughly 12,500 counters across India. And our internal target is to first increase the extraction from these 12,500 counters, and then to look at further expansion. So for this year and next year, I think we have enough to do to get the revenue that we require out of these 12,500 counters.
Okay. And beyond this 12,000, then what could be the next step in terms of increasing penetration?
So if you look at air conditioners, then on the strength of that product, we could easily add another 3,500 counters. So the figure of 12,500 could go to, let's say, 15,500 to 16,000 once the air conditioners are fully placed.
Okay. Thank you, sir.
Yeah. Thank you. Reminder to the participants, anyone who wishes to ask a question may press star and one. As there are no further questions, I would now like to hand the conference over to Mr. Mayank Bhandari for closing comments.
We thank the management for taking time out and sharing their valuable insights on this call. And we also thank all the participants for their presence. Sir, do we have any closing remarks?
Thank you all very much for participating.
Okay, sir. Thank you.
Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, on behalf of Nirmal Bang Equities, that concludes this conference. Thank you for joining us, and you may now disconnect your lines.